Hello and welcome to A Course in Miracles with Miracles One. And this is one of your hosts. This is Deb Phelps. And along with me is Gayle Bartlett and Mary Dole as our hosts today. We have some donor guests with us who may want to share. But I just want to say hello to everyone today. Hello, Gayle. Hello, Mary. Glad to have my miracle co-hosts back. It's been a little bit since we met last.
Hi there. Glad to be here.
Hi, everybody. I'm glad to be here, too.
Okay, so I thought today, since we kind of just talked just a tiny bit before we got started today, and I want to just kind of put the floor out there. If there's anything, we'll start with Gayle and Mary. If there's anything that's been on your mind since the last time we actually, did the last podcast, if there's anything. I know we're still in pandemic. Here we are. Recording this, May the 4th be with you, 2020. Okay, that's me, the geek, the sci-fi fan, all right. You got something there?
Well, actually, I just have a small story of the beauty of how spirit works in our lives. I have a guide dog named Waylon. He's my 10-year-old dog, guide dog, black lab. And I'm retiring him this year because he's losing his vision, which I don't, I want him to have a good place to be. So I wrote to his puppy raiser and several months ago and told him what the vet had said about him losing his eyesight. And, she wrote back immediately and said, I'd love to have him back. If you're willing. Well, of course I am, because she trained him so well and I know she loves him. So of course I wrote back and said, yes. Well, yesterday I wrote her again and I said, I don't know when would be a good time to do the transfer because I don't want you to be endangered. She lives in Montana. I live in Oregon. So let me know what you think and how that might work out. Well, she wrote me back about an hour later and she said, Mary, you're not going to believe this, but I was writing you at the same time you were writing me. She says, I'm taking the dog I just raised to San Diego on the 6th of June, and I could come back through Portland, Oregon, and pick up Waylon. Well, I got chills and tears of joy in my eyes. And I wrote her back, of course, and said, oh, yes, please. That would be wonderful. It'll give me a month to kind of say goodbye to him and so forth. So that's what we're going to do as far as it goes right now. And what I'm telling you this story is about is simply that if I trust spirit, if I really do, things work out. They may not work out exactly as I want them or envision them, but they do work out. And this time it certainly did. So I'm very grateful. And that's all I have right now. I'm done.
That's very cool. Go ahead, Gayle.
That was wonderful, Mary. Thank you so much. I guess the only thing I want to say is that I'm learning the power of just holding space, and there are a lot of people in my life, both here in Chicago as well as more peripherally, my family, my three sisters in various states who are fear-based. And the theme I've been hearing the most is this not being able to interact comfortably with friends and family and have larger family gatherings and so forth. And I'm sure all of you have had that as well in some form. But I'm realizing increasingly, I'll give you a quick example like Mary did. My twin sister's oldest daughter's father-in-law died yesterday, and he was 74, which is almost my age, and he had a recurrence of salivary cancer. It's a long story, which I won't bore you with, but he died yesterday, and his 74-year-old wife, Vicky, has dementia, and she's moving into Alzheimer's, and so she can't live alone, which feels just dreadful. I mean, again, it's just such a long story, but Vicky and Bill, the guy who died, and Vicky, his wife, Stephanie's in-laws, have three sons. And Stephanie's husband, Derek, is a middle son. and they're within close enough proximity where they can support their mom. Anyway, so Lynn was telling us on private messenger yesterday, and then I talked to her for an hour this morning, and there's just a lot going on in the family, obviously, trying to figure out what to do for Vicky and so forth, because she's not, she's ambulatory, but she can't color anymore. She can't watch TV. She can't read a book. She's very compromised. And my heart was very heavy as Lynn was telling me about yesterday and the impact on the family. And I thought, the best thing I can do and listen with no judgment, no comments. And that's exactly what I did until she had talked it out. And then she can come up with her own solutions, how to help Steph and the family and so forth. So I think what I've learned from this coronavirus thing is, how can I be a part of the solution, not a part of the problem? How can I assure that I'm not joined in mass consciousness? How can I be assured that I get above the battleground, and which takes effort sometimes, don't get me wrong. I mean, I'm doing it very imperfectly, but that's okay. So I guess the last thing I want to say is that Mary read the lesson today, and it's really a beautiful meditative lesson and quiet. I received God's word today. Just like I rest in God, which is lesson 109, because I think that brings us back home, if you will. And the more I do that, and the more I make a commitment to my meditative practice, which I'm doing increasingly, just like you, Rev Deb, just like Mary, just like all of us, the safer I feel, the more at peace I feel. I'm done.
Yeah, I would totally agree with that, Gayle. And thank you, Mary, for your sharing as well. When we are at that place of peace, things flow together, you know, like with Mary's story and, you know, and Gayle, you know, that more time that we're spending, then we can be part of the solution and not part of the problem. One of the things that, you know, I've been thinking about, you know, recently is just the blessing of being here, you know, all the time now, like I used to be before I opened my office 2 years ago. So with that, it's, well, now I've been able to work on some things that I had, you know, in the pipeline that I wasn't working on because I'm trying to run a business. Well, I'm trying to run a business. I'm trying to run MiraclesOne behind the scenes now, as many of you know, that, you know, Paul's kind of in the forefront right now. And that's one of the blessings I feel, is that I love that Paul has really stepped up and he's out there and doing the Miracle Toolbox. And I'll have that, you know, I'll have that out, you know, a little bit later today. But it's really great to see and allow people to shine, letting our volunteers shine, Gayle and Mary and Ryan and, you know, Paul and I. But I like being able to be in that background now. That feels like a blessing to me. Also, because what that gives me is that more time to do a lot of inner work. And that's what I've been doing. Besides my coursework, you know, I was sharing my... I won't judge my drawings. I was going to say pathetic drawings, but I'm not going to judge it because that's what we're talking about in the Circle of Peace on Thursdays. We're working on the tolerance section this month from the Manual for Teachers. And so that's exactly what it is, you know, right? Not judging myself. But anyway, the little drawings that I'm doing for my yoga therapy training. And, you know, I wouldn't have been able to do that without this occurring. I wouldn't be able to do, I'm just about done with my aromatherapy certification. I wouldn't have been able to do that without this space and holding that space. And I look at it, well, Spirit must want me to complete these things so I can help other people. I mean, that's where I feel that I've been for a long time, is to meet people where they am. Yeah, aromatherapy isn't a Course in Miracles. Yoga therapy, that's not a Course in Miracles, but I can be the course to everyone that I meet. And that's really what it's all about. Can I have that peaceful presence? Can I have that grounded presence? Can I listen with a, you know, open heart? Can I forgive when I need to forgive, when I see what's going on? I haven't even had time, really, honestly, to even see what's going on in the news. But when I do watch it, can I forgive things that I don't understand or, you know, feel opposite about in any way? And so that for me. And then even with self-reflection, what ways can I work with my well-being? You know, there's things that I've wanted to do for a while, and finally I had the impetus to do it, and I'm feeling better physically. It's to do with my physical health, and I am feeling better physically within the last, I guess it's been 9 days or something like that, and working on that. So what are some things that I can do so I can be a vessel of love, peace, you know, inspiration to others? And it doesn't go without tears too. You know, when you're doing your inner work, and, you know, I do that, you know, every morning. I spend sometimes 2 hours or more, this morning maybe an hour and a half, you know, in journaling and doing that work. And sometimes things arise that are unexpected, that need to be looked at, that have been pushed, you know, to the wayside. Didn't happen today, so I can't really remember to share with you specifically, but if it comes later, I will. So with that, I want to see, I know one of our donors here wanted to share a comment. Bob, did you still want to do that? Yes, you did. Okay. And if, let me just say before you start, our other donors, who are guests today, if you don't want to be on camera, or, well, actually on camera, only the video goes to our donors, but on audio, you can always chat some, you know, put something in the chat box. And, you know, one of us, Gayle or myself, can read it, and we can share whatever that comment or question is too. So, okay, go ahead, Bob.
I guess what I was thinking about was a reflection of a friend of mine who who died recently, who was 90. Now, I don't know where I heard this, but I heard something recently about how the dying have a particular and unique view on life when they know they are at that place, when they're dying. Now, I'm not sure I could put that in, but it's more of an observation. And it just, to go back a little bit of my history, I remember a time when if I knew someone who was in the hospital, I did not go. Because I was afraid to face whatever they were facing in their life, including death. Okay. And then I got close to a man who was dying of cancer a number of years ago. And I just decided that, because he didn't have many people, his family wasn't close to him, I just decided that I would step up and start going to see him as he was progressing through his disease. And I remember hearing this idea that the dying have a unique view of life at that point. And I saw it in him, in this man. As he was dying, he shared a bunch of very personal things with me, including the fact that he and his wife got married when World War II broke out, and he was heading off to the Navy, and they got married. He was telling me this whole story about how they met and fell in love, and I just thought, isn't that wonderful that if I hadn't stepped up to be with him in that time, I would never have heard something like that, a very personal story. Very unique, and it was his time to tell it as well, right? Obviously. It really affected me in a very strong way. And so recently, when this friend of mine was dying, I spent quite a bit of time with him in the last month he was alive. And reflecting back on it, I got the same thing from him that I got from this other man. He knew he was dying, or he knew he didn't have long. You know, he used to joke about not buying green bananas, you know, and because he didn't know how long he was going to be around. So, right? And that's just, what a gift to be around someone at that point in their life. I just hope that I could have that perspective so that, you know, death is not something to be feared, is what I got out of that. And so I've spent any number of times with people, friends who have been dying with them as they were going through that process. And it was such a gift. And I know that it fits perfectly into the philosophy of what is in the course about death not being real. And so anyway, I just thought I would share that because it certainly fits into today's setting with the pandemic. You know, and everybody's got a story about somebody that's been in the hospital or someone they know who died of it, or everybody's touched by this thing. No one's exempt. So anyway, for what it's worth, I just thought I would share that thought. Thanks.
Oh, thanks, Bob. Thanks for sharing that with us. I truly appreciate that. And I just love that. It actually brought up for me, it was a few weeks before my father died, it was like, okay, you better get out here now kind of thing. And he was on the phone with me and he was telling me all kinds of stories. And this is back in 2007. And he was just going on and on. And he was just talking and talking and talking. And why I say this is because anytime I called my father in the past, it was, hi, how you doing? Here, talk to Ellie. Ellie was my stepmother, his wife that he married later on after my parents divorced. And it was like, he's like, you know, I'm not a phone person. You know, I'm not a phone person. And that's what rose to me when you were sharing that, is like those weeks before, I swear he was talking to me for 45 minutes, which was like rare in all our history. And so I can see what you're saying is like, yeah, because he was, I just remember things from his childhood and other, you know, he was in the army, he was in Hamburg, Germany, and, you know, and all these different things that he shared with me. So it was really an experience, and I'm glad that I did make it out in time. And I remember the only thing, by that time, he really couldn't speak too much. He had liver cancer from his many years of alcoholism, functional. and the only thing, you know, when I saw him, I just looked right in his eyes, and in my mind, I just kept, because he was surrounded, you know, like all my aunts and uncles were there, and, you know, so I couldn't say, oh, well, you're not a body. Just go home. But I did say that in my mind. I said, you know, it's okay to follow the light. It's okay to go home. You know, you're with God now. You know, you are as he created you to be. And I could feel it so strongly between us in that, just, you know, when you really look into somebody's eyes, like, how often do we really do that? Do we just really look into someone's eyes? How often do we look into our own eyes? But that's a whole other thing too that we need to work on. But just looking in there and feeling that love and feeling that connection was just absolutely amazing. So I understand what you're saying, Bob, and sharing that. And that's where we see that the spirit is free, right? The Son of God is free. You know, there is no death because there's something so much more. So I'll pause there, see if anyone else would like to share.
This is Mary. I had the privilege of being both with my mom and with my brother as they were going through the process of dying. And in both cases, I guess I'm very grateful because I, having studied the course for many years, and also I've always been a person who doesn't believe that death is the end, I felt such peace. When my mom was dying, my brother was with me, and he said to me, he said, "Mary, you're so calm. How can you be so calm? Our mom's dying." And I said, "Steve, I know where she's going. It's okay." And, you know, I didn't say anything more than that because he wasn't a spiritual person at all. He didn't have any spiritual practice or whatever. So, and when he was dying, I just sat there and held his hand, and sort of like you did, Deb, I didn't say anything out loud, but I kept sending to him or thinking of to him, you're loved and you have nothing to be afraid of. And I had to go home before he actually died, and he died the next day, but they told me that he died very peacefully. So I you know, and during this pandemic, the thing that has struck me is if it's the time for me to go, I know where I'm going to, and I'm not afraid. I don't say I don't fear the process. I do, but I don't fear the ending of the process. I don't fear what it results in. So that's all I have right now. I'm done.
You know, Mary, thank you very much, because what you did was solidify how I feel. I'm not concerned about where I'm going, but if I'm honest, I don't want to die from a dreadful disease where I deteriorate. And that may be partly because I watched my young niece die of brain cancer 2 years ago. Still hard to get that image out of my mind, but what I wanted to share. And so thank you for saying that, Mary, because that clarified where I am as well. When Ken, and some of you have heard me say this, I don't know about Rev Deb, maybe you have. When Ken Wapnick died in 2013 on December 27th, I was flabbergasted, because I had just made the assumption that he would live forever. I'm not sure, excuse me, it was even a conscious assumption. I just thought, this guy is so enlightened and is helping so many of us better understand the Course. How could he have died? It was such a shock to me. And I read later on, he died of liver disease or liver cancer or something very quickly. Within 3 weeks, he was gone. And as he was dying, he said to his beloved family, Gloria was his wife, "I'm not dying. I am not dying." In other words, please don't be fearful for me. Don't be sad that I will no longer be here in form. And that slowly, his death slowly but surely has helped me to realize, in his case, with my reverence for him, I had made that very special. It made me feel better that he was alive and well, until at which time he was no longer. And then it was, oh my God, that means, and he was just a couple years older than me. He was born in 44. And I thought, oh, it brought it back to me and my own fears about death, and feeling like maybe subconsciously, if I'm really dutiful and I try to apply the Course really diligently, I can live a long life, a long, healthy life. I'm just being honest, which was delusional, because as I've read in Ken Wapnick's works, and when someone is sick and dying or whatever, it was never about the form. It was about what was in the mind and how one approached whatever might have been happening with his or her body. And I don't want to hear that. I don't want to read that, you know, because I don't know that I've, not to belabor this, but I don't know that I've fully accepted the fact, like Mary and probably all of you, I don't know that I'm ready to leave Gracie, for example. I'm not sure, you know, maybe my family and all of you, but she would be, I know it sounds insane. It sounds insane, but she's really attached to me, and what would she do? And Bill loves her dearly, but she prefers me. I know that sounds insane because it is, but that's where I am. And what I've learned from working with MiraclesOne and Rev Deb and Mary and all of you is that you just have to accept where you are and not fight it, but just say, okay, this is where I am. I don't want to leave my dog. But I'm pretty healthy. I mean, at least today I am. So, okay, I'm done. Let's give everyone else a chance to contribute if they'd like to. I'm done.
Yes, and if, you know, those who were guests today, and if you don't want to come on the mic to share today, you can put it in the chat box and any thoughts, any questions that you may have in relation to our impromptu, I will say, discussion today. Thanks to Bob for bringing that up today, because I think it's a good topic to look at as well as, you know, as course students, because right now we're faced with numbers every single day upticking all around the world. And, you know, at times I know I've looked at those and like, it's like unbelievable. I mean, we are in a very unusual time that hasn't really happened for what, 100 years or something. And it's something that will be remembered. And how can I deal with this? And I think that's where I go back to our personal practices too. We can really see how much our practice has benefited us, or maybe I better up my game a little bit with my practice and what's going on. And this is why, you know, one of the things I always talk about, and some of you probably have heard me ad nauseum, is it's not about, you know, just reading the book, right? It's not about just reading the book. This one looks like it's very well read. Yeah, of course, I've had it for 30 years, but that doesn't mean anything. Those words on that page, and I've said it over and over again, probably a lot of podcasts, where, hey, if I can't live it from my heart, you know, that means jack squat, really. It's about, you know, and death is just not about that. It's about judgment, right? It's about the fear. All of that is a death to us in that way. Let's see, anyone else, any other thoughts? We have just a few minutes left. I want to give that opportunity. Yeah, maybe a few words. Okay, maybe a few words. Manual for teachers. Always a manual for teachers, right? Even though we were working on the text, and we'll return to that at some point, whenever, maybe when things get a little bit more all clear, we can return to that, because I want to give that opportunity to bring up subject matter that really helps us in any way. And even the last time that we did that, we had some other people come on, and you know, they wanted to share some other things. And of course, I can't find it. Maybe it's in the workbook. This is where I ask Gayle to help me.
What are you looking for, Deb?
Oh, isn't there a "What is death" or something? My mind's not.
There's a lesson in there, Mary. What is a lesson? There is no death.
Yeah, that's not what I was looking for.
Where the heck? That's not what you're looking for?
No, because there's the resurrection, and then there's...
Page 7.
Hmm? Oh, there's resurrection. Okay, wait a minute. What is death? Page 66 in the manual.
Okay.
7. Is that what you just said, Bob?
Manual for teachers, 27.
Yeah, 27, yeah. So we're not going to go through this whole entire thing, but just so, you know, like if you're a newbie and... you know, you're like, okay, I want a reference. What can I read about this? So it's in the Manual for Teachers 27. And that's something that we can look at here. There we go. So death is the central dream from which all illusions stem. Is it not madness to think of life as being born, aging, losing vitality, and dying in the end? Well, that's what we think here in the world, right? Yeah. We have asked this question before, but now we need to consider it more carefully. It is the one fixed, unchangeable belief of the world that all things in it are born only to die. This is regarded as the way of nature, not to be raised to question, but to be accepted as the natural law of life. the cyclical, the changing and unsure, the undependable and the unsteady, waxing and waning in a certain way upon a certain path, all this is taken as the will of God. And no one asks if a benign creator would will this. Okay, so I'm going to jump down to 3, and he says, death is the symbol of the fear of God. His love is blotted out in the idea, which holds it from awareness like a shield held up to obscure the sun. The grimness of the symbol is enough to show it cannot coexist with God. It holds an image of the Son of God in which he is laid to rest in devastation's arms, where worms, yeah, you read that right, where worms, I had to look twice. I think some little gremlins put words in here, where worms wait to greet him to last a little while by his destruction. Yet the worms as well are doomed to be destroyed as certainly, and so do all things live because of death. Devouring is nature's law of life. God is insane and fear alone is real. And okay, well, that's what we need to overcome, right? The last thing to overcome, he jumps over to, you know, we jump over to paragraph 6, is death, right? Without the idea of death, there is no world. It's a dream, like all the other dreams that we have, even of what we think of as life here in this world, right? And that's something to really consider and to think about. And as we know, we've been surrounded by so much death every day on the news, and you know, and even, you know, you see different celebrities, and like today, Don Shula, the coach of the Dolphins, I hope that's right, it's always like somebody else has died, and we look at our mortality, and oh wow, you know. And then you hear people, I finally heard for the first time of somebody that I know that has COVID or had COVID, that they've pretty much recovered now. And it's like, yes, it's starting to touch us. And you know, and as Bob shared earlier, we're all going to know somebody who knows somebody that has passed because of it. So what can we do is but continue to remind ourselves that yes, here in the world, we're going to grieve. We're, you know, we're going to be sad. We're going to do what we need to do. If we're with somebody, you know, we're going to make them comfortable in whatever way. Or, you know, right now, a lot of people are just kind of doing it through, FaceTime or whatever, because you can't go in the hospitals. But we're going to do whatever we can to help people feel comfortable in their loss. You know, by listening, by being there, by holding that sacred space, whatever we can do. Also remembering in our mind, now, of course, we can't go around and tell people, oh, well, that's the last illusion. Who's going to, you know, they're going to put you in psych ward if you say that, right? But, you know, you don't want to do that. What you want to do is, as I've been saying for some time now, meet people where they are so you can know the course concepts in your mind. But now, can I be a human being and love people here in the world, right? Knowing that that's not who I am. I'm not this body, right? That death is not real. But can I still share the message of love to everyone? Everyone I meet, everyone I see, every news story I hear. Can I do that? And that's something to really consider. So there's some homework for y'all who are listening today. So read more of that manual for teachers lesson. Number 27, what is death? And see what comes up for you with that. Maybe do some journaling with that. Come to our study groups and maybe you want to talk with, one of our groups about that very thing. And so with that, I'll check in with Gayle and Mari for any last words, and then we'll close up for today.
I totally agree with you, Deb. It's not about preaching or, you know, standing on the corner and yelling, the world is an illusion. It's because what we have to do is first, we have to accept these concepts ourselves. We can't do a darn thing to help anyone else if we don't accept them for ourselves. So, that's our task, and I'm very grateful that I have the time to work on that, and I'm done.
Yeah, I agree with both of you. I guess what I wanted to say is, you know, we're coming up to a lesson, I think, which is basically to give is to receive. And I find, as I said at the very beginning, that the more, for me, the more I can be in the moment, even if I'm fearful, and the more present I am with anybody I'm talking to on the phone, on a forum, or in person, that is a form of giving. And rather than for me to talk gibberish about how many deaths and all that, which I've done, by the way, I've done that. I have definitely done that, gotten into the drama, no question. But the more I withdraw, as Rev Deb, you said really beautifully, that you've shifted the paradigm from at the very beginning of this to looking at it in a very positive, meaningful way, where you're getting your aromatherapy certification and so forth. So not only am I trying to learn how to hold space and not just wait for someone to stop talking so I can talk, which I've certainly done too, but it's also shifting my paradigm with Bill working from here predominantly, which at times drives me insane. And I'm sure I drive him insane because he's just down the hall from me. And a lot of times I have to leave the door open so he doesn't get kicked off a Zoom webinar or something. And then Deb was telling me this morning, emails are bouncing back. Well, that we've got two people here trying to use the most advanced technology we have that we've paid for. But my whole point is this. I think it's just being as present as we can be. And as Rev Deb was saying, even if we do a half-assed, haphazard job of practicing, which I do on any given day, it's remembering it doesn't have to be done perfectly. And as Bob always says, I'm going to make mistakes every single day, but I'm not a mistake. So if I can get beyond labeling myself as a screw up, or what's wrong with me, I'm doing the same thing that I vowed I wouldn't do yesterday, because I do that. I absolutely do that, get into drama, melodrama and all that in my mind, even if I don't say it. So I think it's just keep calm and carry on, which is what Churchill said during World War II. Keep calm and carry on. And I'm done. And I'm so happy to be here with all of you.
Wonderful. Yeah, keep calm and carry on and stay with your mighty companions. And dear listeners, we thank you so much for listening and being with us. And if you haven't, you know, joined in on one of our study groups, we have a study group right now on Sunday mornings, all central times. I'm going to share here Sundays at 10:30 a.m., Tuesdays at 7 p.m., and Wednesdays at 12:30 p.m. as well. And we have a Facebook group, our practical application Facebook group. And then we also have an email, what I call an email study group, forum, whatever you want to call it. And you can find all that information on our website, www.miraclesone.org. And certainly if you want to support us at this time, we're all volunteers, myself and Paul, you know, included. All the monies that come in help to keep servers going and Zoom, because we have a couple of host accounts with that, you know, keeps everything going that we do, so we can continue to make sure that we give as much as we can freely to A Course in Miracles students all over the world, so they can deepen their practice and study as well. So thank you to our donors who were with us today as well for joining us. And that's gift that we give to our donors, that they can participate with us if they'd like to as well. So thanks everybody for joining us today. And as always, I wish you much peace. Namaste.